उस डिसेबल्ड पार्टिसिपेंट, ओके। निमी,
ट्राई नाउ मैम.
या होल्ड ऑन, इट ओके? ऑल
हाँ
राइट, नाउ यू कैन लेट ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स इन
हाँ
एंड ठीक है, और
ठीक.
वो तुम कर देना।
हाँ वो मैं कर.
अच्छा सर हाँ अभी हुआ। हेलो एवरीवन, हेलो 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 हेलो
ऑल आर ऑन अनम्यूट।
हेलो
हाँ मैम,
गुड मॉर्निंग।
गुड मॉर्निंग, आ रहे हैं?
यस।
चलो, सो गुड मॉर्निंग ऑल, कैन वी स्टार्ट? मनीषा रेडी?
या गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
गुड मॉर्निंग, सो कैन वी स्टार्ट?
Yes, we can start.
Fine.
I think people will log in gradually.
They will start joining, no issue. We can continue with the time schedule.
Yes.
It is already, we are delayed by 7 minutes. Hello, good morning all friends.
Morning.
This is once again, Vijay Shah is with you. And as an Exim Club motto, we are here to provide you the educational guidelines on or your day-to-day life. We wanted to motivate you all during this COVID time so that you can maintain your health as well as your professional business. In our association, we have a number of SME people as well as the entrepreneurs are there, employees are there. So we would like to cover all our webinar series in a such a way that all entrepreneurs can also get the beneficial, corporate can get benefits of it, as well as all the employees can also get themselves educated and learn on their own. This is what our motto is. And with this motto, we are also giving a special thrust on the marketing part also, so that over a period, people can work on their own product line, and each and every person can know each other within our group, so that people, for their requirement, they should have not to go in for here and there. This is number one. Number two, we are also keeping the webinar series for this innovation part also. So over a period, you can get the benefit on that, because in the current situation, there are three parts are covered. One is maintaining the health. Second is maintaining the finance. Third is maintaining your own marketing strategy. And overall of it, how to sustain with the current business. If the current business is not viable, what is the line where we need the innovation? Which way innovation is needed? Whether we need to look into this finance innovation, or we should invented our own product line, or we should think over the altogether different line where we can switch over. So all these questions are very much there, and we at Exim Club is planning that we try to mitigate all these problems as far as possible and give the members this kind of a open platform so that they can get the benefit from their different personalities across the globe. I request all the members, wherever you feel anything special thing, be in touch with the Exim office, give your feedback, give your suggestions, give your modification, so that whatever we are doing from our side, it can be modified as per the needs of the members. Today, we have with us Mahisha ma'am, she is one of the committee member also with us, and since last year she has already joined with us. This year also she is continuing with us as the executive committee member, and she is basically a good faculty members. She has already working with this Jebisha and company as a faculty, and she is a taking the number of such kind of the faculty as a classes. So, and she has given a consent to Exim Club also to conduct the class on this export import, all the related subjects and that, and she has agreed to take that classes on behalf of the Exim. So today this is one of the things, and she is take through us how do we can get rid of this COVID, how we can increase our export business, and how we can sustain during this time period. Thank you all. Let's Manisha, you can just take the floor and apprise on each and every member on about your lecture, and whatever the questions will be there, we will take up at the end of the your presentation.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, President Mr. Vijay Shah, for introducing me, and a very good morning to all the lovely participants, attendees. I see so many people are yet getting joined, and it will be a very nice session to talk to all of them. So,
Manisha,
yes, sir.
Manisha, I'm just interrupting just for a 1 minute. I really forgot to introduce today with us the Exim Guru TNC Rajgopalan is with us in this forum.
Yeah.
And he is the my godfather, and he is a godfather for a number of entrepreneurs also in and around Baroda. He is a very supremo in this language.
All right.
Sir, I salute you, sir.
All right. Thank you. Welcome to Mr. TNC Rajgopalan. And I also would like to introduce Mr. Suyal Labidi. He is a veteran of foreign trade, and who is also with us in this forum. So I'm sure we can get some insights from him as well after the end of the session. So welcome, sir, and welcome to all the participants. Thank you, Exim Club, for giving me this opportunity. And as our today's session is very much interesting and very hot topic about challenges and opportunities of exports, you know, during and post COVID-19. So I will start with a Ganesh sloka, that Vakratunda Mahakaya Surya Koti Samaprabha Nirvignam Kurume Deva Sukarya Sasarvada. So I'm sure all of us need blessings from Lord Ganesha to move forward. Lord Ganesha is considered one of the gods for prosperity and wisdom. And today all exporters who are joining with us definitely needs, you know, the blessings from our God. Yeah. So we will move today, and we will be talking, you know, about various challenges in exports. As exports is an integral part of our Indian economy, and the COVID-19 outbreak, you know, has brought us a lot of unprecedented changes in the entire world. Not even one country has been left unaffected because of COVID-19 outbreak. Yeah. So this was really a big pandemic, and it is affecting the Indian economy as well. So today, you know, with the platform of Exim Club, we will be reaching out, you know, many exporters, and we will be discussing how, you know, we can try to minimize our losses, and how, as an exporter, who are the real heroes of Indian economy, who are the real heroes, you know, in bringing back our old good days. So how the exporters can really perform well, how the exporters can really relook into their options, you know, that how to go ahead, the roadmap. So yes, we will be discussing, and India, yes, definitely is moving in a very, very fast way. And we are trying to come back to our old good days. And yes, you know, this is one of the, I think, best opportunity for us you know, to how we can go fast and how we can, you know, cover the shortfalls which we had in the early quarter, you know, April, May, June, you know, 3 months. So let us discuss some points, and I would like to share, and I will run through some updated informations what we have received, and we will also discuss about these strategies. Yeah, so I will be happy enough to share my screen with all of you, and I will just see you at the presentation. I hope the presentation is viewable to all of you. Yeah, so this is going to be our today's discussion. All right, that is, we are going to discuss on India's foreign trade. Then we will be also running through the four main pillars of exports, which I feel that the exporters can, you know, concentrate on these four pillars, so that, you know, they can revive or reboot, you know, the Indian economy, as well as the challenges and opportunities in exports. Yeah. So the main strategy, what I feel, in my opinion, of after the COVID-19 would be to the exporters, you know, should try to discover. I think now new markets are more important, to go to new markets, because now the world is under the pandemic. Some countries have already opened, some countries are still under lockdown, and the exporters may not be using their own traditional way of contacting the buyers. So I think they should start relooking the old buyer, whether the buyer is still available for doing the business, or whether the buyer is still willing to procure the goods from India, or, you know, there are some new markets opening. All right. So that could be one of the strategy. Second important strategy, what I would feel, is to have the mentorship and guidance to the budding exporters. All right. The new startups, entrepreneurs may require a lot of guidance. Today, nowadays, a lot of free informations, webinars are being hosted, you know, on digital platform. Government themselves are taking so much interest in reaching out to the exporters and giving a guidance. And even the new startups should also, I think, take advantage of the guidances to how to move ahead, so that, you know, they don't get stuck up anywhere. Third important is to promote the local products into the global markets. Yeah, so this is, I think, one of the Make in India initiative that what has been taken by the Indian government, and even after making the products domestically, you know, we can definitely try to export. All right. And to deliberate on government schemes and incentives for exporters. Yeah. So a lot of schemes and incentives are being made available. You know, we all can log in to the dgft.gov.in website and try to avail those benefits. Yeah. So that is one important thing. About the COVID-19, as you know, we all know what has happened, and you know, it has really hampered the Indian economy, the world's economy, and there has been lot of losses in terms of business. But if we compare, you know, the exports threats versus opportunities, if you see, the threat is, yes, the COVID-19 outbreak in India started during the March, okay, and during the closing of the financial year itself, you know, we were not able to do the jobs, exporters were not able to fulfill, and then lot of things started moving in the end of March. All right, we also see another important threat is the border tensions with our neighbors, like the wars, okay, the Ladakh and the China and India, and, you know, all those border tensions are happening, the trade wars are affecting the economies very badly, all right? But at the same time, if we see or compare it, you know, with the opportunities, you know, then yes, there is definitely an innovative growth, because I feel that COVID-19 is more like an opportunity for us rather than a threat. You know, we cannot be sitting, okay, COVID-19, and you know, certain things. But yes, the world has to move, our businesses has to move, our companies have to move, you know, and everybody has to grow. So I think a lot of opportunities and innovative growths is we foresee, you know, because India is having a huge potential in so many products, especially in the export sectors. And, you know, India is really going to do well. And yes, certain focusing on certain marketing, you know, or certain countries, that is an opportunity where COVID-19 has maybe having a little effect. If we see countries like Australia, if we see countries like New Zealand, you know, these countries were less affected compared to the other European countries. So it is time for us or time for the exporters to look into those markets and explore those countries, you know, so that your product and your business, you know, you have to keep moving, you know. So that could be one of the strengths. And nevertheless, it is our duty, you know, as an Indian citizen, we must strengthen, you know, the local brand image. Yeah. So this is what I feel is the, you know, threats versus opportunities. And yes, the world has really shaken this COVID-19. And first is, you know, there had been significant losses of human lives. You know, this is the biggest threat, you know, compared to any other threat in any sector. If you see, you know, the human lives, it's so saddening that pandemic has killed so many people. You know, because of that, there has been, you know, the stock market has gone down, then the manufacturing disrupted operations was there all over the world. Then, you know, the global markets were also falling because of the pandemic worldwide. Then supply chain disruptions were there, as everybody knew that importer and exporter were sitting in lockdown countries. The goods were not passing, the ports were not operating, you know, in certain cases. So the total, the supply chain got disturbed. Then there has been a lot of reduction in the international trade. Yeah. So if we compare and see so many threats, you know, it is very difficult to come out of this huge threats which has happened worldwide. Yeah. So very important that all exporters, you know, get together, find out some solutions and how we can reboot, you know, our Indian economy, our Indian exports. That is very, very important. If you see the global coronavirus figures, you know, at the right side of the slide, you can see where India is almost touching about 10 lakhs cases and about, you know, 25,000 deaths. So this figure is really, really very huge. And we must try to, yes, now the government is definitely working in reducing the mortality rate, you know, and seeing how best, you know, we can reach to all to control, you know, this kind of pandemic. So this is about the threats what the world is facing. And yes, now let us understand, you know, that as India being a democratic country and a huge population and a huge you know, potential, where does India stand in this pandemic situation, and what is going to be our role? How can we come out of this pandemic situation very, very easily? So this slide I would just like to run through is the world's top 20 exports countries. These are the figures of 2019, that was before the pandemic. All right, and here you can see the China is leading, and it's having about $24.99 billion. All right, $2,499 billions is the sales exports of China. All right, and you can see United States is leading in number two, Germany is number three, Netherlands is number four, and you can see the other countries, all right, that these figures are recorded in US dollars, in billions, and India stands on 18th position, you know, having $322 billions of sales turnover, all right. So here we can see that India is still at number 18 position in the world, and how fast we need to run, you know, to overcome all the people or all the countries who are ahead of us, all right? If we see the foreign trade policy, our government is doing an excellent job, you know, for extending the foreign trade policy, which was otherwise about to expire on the 31st of March 2020, but yes, we got one more year extension by the government, and that itself is giving a good motivation to all the exporters to continue with the same scheme, to continue with the same benefit, same incentives, till such time everything goes normal. So yes, you can see on this that government of India has set up an export target of $900 billion by 2020, all right? That was an estimation by the government of India. And if we can see the India's exports, the total exports is 528, all right? So it is like we are more or less a little lagging behind, and maybe because of pandemic, we were not able to touch 900 billions. But yes, definitely the shortfall, we have to try to gear up in the coming days. Yeah, this is the latest information which I would like to share with everyone, is the India's foreign trade April, May and June. You're right, that is the 2020, and here you can see the exports in the 3 months was about 51.32 billion and imports was about 60.44 million. All right, and there was a trade deficit for the mercantile exports of $9.12 billion. But if you see the overall mercantile and the service exports, all right, 101 billion was the total overall exports, compared to imports was about 89, and the trade surplus for the 3 months was 11.70 billion. So this is the first time in the last decade India has become a net exporter, all right? Because we have a trade surplus for June 2020, and this itself is giving us a lot of power, you know, to that, yes, India can do, India can run at a very fast speed. And this is the latest slide, you know, the last decade that India is a net exporter. All right, so meanwhile, if you see the imports in the month, they were recorded at $21.11 billion. And in terms of dollars or in terms of rupees, if we see, all right, that is about $40.29 billion crores, you know, in the last June month. So that itself shows that, yes, because India is the first time in the history of India has become a net exporter. And if you see, you know, during the pandemic during the pandemic time, the India's mercantiles, all right, the goods that were really going are having a positive growth during June 2020, you know, was as compared to June 19, all right? That is iron ore, oil seeds, rice, you can see oil meals, spices, other cereals, organics and inorganic chemicals, cereal preparations, miscellaneous processed items, fruits and vegetables, drugs, pharmaceuticals, tobacco, and coffee, you know, these were the only products which were moving worldwide during the pandemic. And even after the post-lockdown, these products was having a huge demand. So you can see, exporters can really see of changing their products if required. And, you know, you can see which country is having a stimulus of a demand of these kind of products. And the products which showed, you know, the negative growth in India, at least till June compared to 2019, that is gems and jewelry, leather products, man-made yarns, then petroleum, because yes, the people were in lockdown, everybody was sitting in their houses, there was no need for people to move out, so definitely petroleum also, you know, have recorded a negative growth. Cashew, meat, dairy products, okay? These are engineering goods. Yes, engineering goods has also given a negative growth compared to the last year figures, all right? And so you can see from this slide that which are the products which was really in demand and which are the industries, which are the sectors which has given a negative growth, all right? So I would like to start about the new strategies, you know, the four main pillars we will be discussing, all right, about exports. If we don't have any goal in our mind, or if we don't set any goal in our mind, we will not be able to run through that roadmap which we have made, all right? So on your screen, you will see that India's export forecast, all right, this is increasing value addition to exports. So every exporter, every entrepreneur should really feel, or, you know, try to increase value addition to the export. If we are not adding value, then the products may not be sold, or maybe you will lose the market. You will lose the client also, and you will lose that industry also. So now is the time for all of us to think out of the box so that we can revive our export policies and we can, you know, enter and penetrate into the market. And we are, you know, ready to our buyers to give them anything they want. India is having a huge potential, and India is a powerhouse of so many products, so many sectors, you know. So we can definitely increase value. And some of the examples which I would like to share is the products on specialty chemicals and processed foods. I mean, I like processed foods, and you know, this is a very attractive sector, you know, where there is a lot of growth, a lot of market. And medicinal plants and herbs, if you look into this, medicinal plants and herbs that nowadays everyone are for, you know, changing their mindsets, and from allopathy they are all coming into Ayurveda, and Ayurveda has given a lot of growth also. So food processing, Ayurveda based health products, these are all the value added products and processed foods. Yeah, these markets will grow tremendously, all right? So those exporters who are just exporting as a commodity may try to look into new values, you know, to add values, all right? You can try to look into ready-to-eat products, all right, like organic chickies. If you export groundnuts, yes, maybe the market will not be there, because maybe India is a huge producer of groundnuts. But there are some countries who are not buying groundnuts from India because we are not able to meet that quality or that taste, or, you know, that shipping time what they require. So that is why they are not procuring groundnuts from us, certain European countries. But yes, if we are processing those same groundnuts into organic chickies. Chicky does not require very hi-fi technology or, you know, that kind of preparation. It is very easy. So you can, you know, very well enter into those markets. And the market is huge, but nobody is selling these kind of processed foods, you know. But yes, if somebody takes interest, then yes, this can very well grow tremendously. Even if you see the organic granula bars, so these are granula bars is nowadays in fashion, and you know, it's a very quick ready to eat food. It is available in all supermarkets. But yes, if we can really try to process some of these ingredients, you know, and make it as a ready to food where hi-fi technology is not required, yes, definitely we can hit to all the markets, because this kind of product is having a huge demand worldwide, you know. Then even onion, ginger powder, pickles, again, you know, Indian pickles are famous, famous worldwide. So that is also one good source of exporting frozen potatoes for French fries, you know, but nobody is exporting frozen potatoes, I think so. So French fries is also in huge demand. All right. So this is again some ready to export essential products. The exports of the essential products, that is mask, then face shields, thermal gun, thermal thermometers, all right, then the PPE kits, all right, ventilators. These are all the medical products in which the demand is huge, demand is increasing, and India has done tremendously well, you know, in manufacturing all these medical devices. And these FMCG, that is ready to eat products, as you can see, is having a huge market. Fruits and vegetables, yeah, now people are, you know, considered, everyone has become health conscious, instead of eating canned foods and you know, the frozen foods, people now want to divert into fresh fruits. And you know, this is really helping the people to stay healthy and increase their immunities. So that is one good thing, that how fruits and vegetables are you know, important. So you know, there is one suggestion that to use of reefer container transportation for the exports of fruits and vegetables. I think so, that traditionally the fruits and vegetables has been transported by air, all right, and which has limited their markets you know, only to neighboring countries like Gulf countries or Singapore and Hong Kong and, you know, all those areas. But yes, these countries, the exporters in states of Kerala and Tamil Nadu have really cornered this trade. But Gujarat is having a huge potential, all right, of certain fruits and vegetables which we are not even looking to explore because of the high cost of the air freight. But yes, there was one study which was taken at Varanasi, all right, in India, by exporting mangoes to the UK Felixstowe port, and those containers have been gone from Navashiva, and it has gone to UK, and the vegetables and fruits you know, were really in good condition in the reefer transportation, and that kind of a quality of fruits and vegetables were stored inside that refrigerated containers. The temperature was set, and then at destination, when they found the quality was really very good, and in a way they have saved 60% of the cost. The logistics cost was saved, you know, by using this kind of rep. So it was just an experiment that went from India to check about these fruits and vegetables. And as we all know, that the transit time from India to UK is about 25 days, and you know, again another 4-5 days to reach the buyer's warehouse, or you know, to the end user. So same way, Gujarat is a producer of mangoes, Kesar mangoes, you know. So Kesar mangoes can also reach you know, these kind of destinations in China. China is now coming up, and recently the Xinjiang premium fruit market has been developing as a hub for fruits and vegetables. So we can look into this area by sending our Indian foods and vegetables to China. And you know, the transit time is, I think, lesser than UK. So these fruits can definitely stay in good condition, and they can very well go to the other sides. Yeah. Yes, now I would like to discuss, that was about the pillar one. All right, now I would like to discuss about the second pillar of exports, that is discovering new markets for existing products. Yeah, this is the discussion of the hour, that we need to discuss on the new markets. Where is the new market? Whether that market is still under lockdown condition, or that market is now, you know, coming up aggressively and they want to buy certain things. So the top five export destinations, all right, like UAE, USA, Hong Kong, China, Saudi Arabia, these countries are now coming up. All right, and these are the Indian exports are going regularly to these countries. We can also identify emerging hotspots, yeah, like Africa, Asia, and Latin America. So these are the hotspots for Indian products, but nobody is looking into Africa, West Africa, because of certain reasons. But yes, now exporters can really, you know, if they feel that Germany is not responding well, or Italy is not responding well to their old traditional methods, exporters can start looking into new countries. All right, like these are the hotspots, and Africa is also coming up in a very big way, and a lot of investors, you know, even foreign investors, Chinese investors, everybody is investing into Africa for building certain products. I think we can also look into New Zealand and Australia. These are the countries which was least affected because of virus. And if there is a buyer, you know, buyer is always there. You can always try to sell your products in these routes, so that your exports can keep rolling. Again, another important what I see is the new supply chain routes really needs to be developed, because in this pandemic there was a total disruption of the supply chain. And yes, if we can look into new routes, you know, earlier the government had recommended Iran moving to Europe via Iran, but I would not recommend via Iran route, because Iran multimodal routes to Europe, and it has run into grave difficulties due to the Chinese agreement on infrastructure with the Iran. And it has also resulted in our losing control on the Chabahar port operations. All right, so there are even new routes, all right, wherein India can do really well. There was a route which was made by government a few years back to Thailand, all right, via Burma, that is by road. If the new routes are opening from India via Burma to Thailand, because from Thailand there are openings to the Vietnam and east coast of China, but again there are so many problems in this route, the land and the borders and visa problems and language problems. So although this route was recommended, but it's so many years, work is still not done. So even this is just an information that we can look of other kind of new routes where the logistics can be decreased, you know, because now companies are looking how to synchronize the supply chain. Instead of long supply chains, companies are definitely looking into how they can reduce. Yeah, so again, that is more important. And the fast track of the API production for the global dominance, the active pharmaceutical ingredient. You know, today India is the world's pharmacy. It is known as world's pharmacy, and you know, that is why during the pandemic, when no other country was able to send the goods, India was the first one to send you know, our hydrochloroquinine to America and Brazil. And you know, that product was restricted, but then because of the demand, that product had to be freely exportable, and we started moving hydrochloroquinine. It's an anti-malarial drug. So pharmacy is huge, you know, and API exports are approximately $5 billion from India due to COVID-19 and Chinese companies closures. Export markets are very favorable to India. So now companies are, you know, all foreign companies are now trying to close their associations, their long relationship with China, and everybody is looking at India. There are some pharmaceutical inquiries that has been generated from the Western countries for India, which otherwise they did not even look at India. But yes, after the Chinese economy, you know, falling down, and COVID-19, nobody wants to go to China, and you know, it's a favorable for India. And Gujarat, I feel, is a significant exporter for pharmaceuticals. We have huge pharmaceutical companies in Gujarat, and you know, they are growing at a very high rate. All the industries during the pandemic were shut down, but pharma was the only one, you know, which was rolling. And I know many of my friends in the pharma companies were working 24/7, and other than doctors and nurses, you know, even I feel that the people of the pharma are also called as corona warriors. They also have fought all the way from all these pandemic situations, and they have been at office and, you know, supplied the drugs, and, you know, what we call it as a Sanjeevani for the people of India and as well as the people of the world. So marketing efforts are huge. And if we see the API commissioning, you know, of the Bharuch API park, you know, I think just some land has been acquired, or the policy has been declared, but no work has been done so far for this Bharuch API park. So I think if government looks into the fast track commissioning, then of this could be a really boon, you know, to the pharmaceutical exports of our country. Yeah. So one of the first changes that must be implemented by all the exporters is the inventory levels. All right. So I think pandemic has taught us a lesson. The pandemic has made us all aware about how to save ourselves and keep the wheel moving, is to check the inventory levels are always high. You never know when this kind of the pandemic you know, would come again, or put us all into a deep stress, and you know, we will not be able to fight against this. Looking at fresh markets, yes, that we have already discussed. Larger companies, you know, may hold a monopoly to the market. You know, here we can see that if there are big companies, if you see Reliance, if you see Adani's, and you know, the big exporters, yes, because of their monopoly in selling certain products in some markets, they may survive. But the small entrepreneurs, the small MSMEs, the small SMEs, you know, will have a very, very difficult situation to fight out this stress, you know. So inventory levels needs to be checked, and whenever you talk with the buyer, try and cut down the shortening of the supply chains. All right. So here I would like to just discuss about the 7 R's of logistics. That is, I being a logistician, working in a logistics company, you know, the 7 R's, I really believe and work that the 7 R's is like a rapidly evolving business discipline, you know, order processing, warehousing, transportation, material packaging, handling, you know, all these needs to be integrated, you know, through a network of facilities. So now it is going to be very difficult for us to maintain these 7 hours, because now people are alert about having social distancing. There are people who are having certain concepts of work from home, you know, so certain things may not be possible. But then, yes, to move the integrated supply chain, we need to take care of all these hours, and we need to see that things are moving, you know, in a proper way. If we see the government of India and being in logistics, you know, there are certain measures I would like to just highlight. And those who are the regular exporters, I think they must be already aware that these were the measures taken by the Central Board of Indirect Taxes and Customs. You know, now we are in the world of digitization, and in fact, most of the activities has been paperless, all right, in customs also. But after this pandemic, electronic communication of PDF gate passes, final out of charge bill of entries, exemption of customs duties on health sesh, on medical equipments, then clearance of goods without original certificate of origin, then acceptance of undertaking in lieu of bond, 24/7 customs clearance. All right, so these are the various measures, all right, the government has taken to facilitate the importer, you know, from even having some relaxations on late fees and damages. I think when we had the initial stage, a lot of shipping lines had supported the importers by waiving out all these fees and damages and, you know, certain things. So if we see, you know, the impact on sea freight, today is the impact on the sea freight, impact of coronavirus on the sea freight is it is permitting to resume to work. Yeah, because now we have a lot of relaxations and everybody wants to work and it has been permitted. And yes, there is some congestions at the ports, all right. The storage and some containers are stuck because of delayed clearance, but gradually the port is also helping, you know, to clear out those containers one by one. And there are certain voyage cancellations also, because the voyage also needs certain amount of containers to be on board, and then only, you know, they can fix up. But if there are not enough containers coming, then some voyages are either cancelled or either delayed. All right. And yeah, Europe, USA, these are all the trade lanes which the liner themselves are relooking, because even USA, the condition is very bad because of the COVID. It's also having a lot of rules for entry of any containers coming from the COVID countries. Yeah, so a lot of things are there, and freight rates are also very, very volatile. So, you know, not only sea freight, but I think the air freight impact is huge on coronavirus. And I don't know when this air freight is going to again come back to its old, you know, volumes. As we all know that passenger flights has been canceled. We only have the options of freighter flights. And freighter flights is in low demand. It's only for essentials and emergencies, shipments. That is being ordered from various countries. Yeah, a lot of charter flights are also cancelled because of the COVID-19. And almost, if you see, there is a drop of 65% in the air freight traffic as compared to 2019. And because even limited staff is also on duty, already 40% to 50% staff is on duty at the airlines, at the airports. So definitely this industry is also going to take little time to come back of the COVID. I would like to now further move ahead in our presentation by discussing the third pillar of exports, that is adding new products to the export basket. So the first and the foremost is about the PPE kits and the corona testing kits. You know, this is a magnificent example, you know, what we Indians have really proved, all right, about the PPE kits and the corona testing kits. That was the first testing kits India was able to make, you know, for testing the COVID. Second is the hydrochloroquinine that I already discussed is an anti-malarial drug, and India was the first one to export when rest of the world was in the lockdown situation, and India was very proudly exporting hydrochloroquinine to countries like USA and Brazil. And that was really a tremendous enthusiasm and a tremendous power which we Indians were able to generate. Yeah, again, new products in defense also, we can start looking it into. If you see INS Chennai, you know, is an example of a make in India Indian Navy, how they made all the domestic products, you know, INS Chennai, and how that particular ship, and you know, that has been able to function. Even we can look into certain preparations of drones and unnamed aerial vehicles. This is also going to be in demand. Drones are also important for certain scanning and certain informations about this kind of a COVID. Electronics and IT equipments, you can add value. Because now the world is under digitization, everybody has adopted the digitizations, and you know, everyone wants to work from their home, their laptops, they want to have the internet facilities and then reach out the world, because this is the only way left to save yourself from the pandemic and continue your work. So lot of, and now the country was in shortage of laptops, because whatever was there was already sold out. So today, you know, the electronic industry can also, you know, give new products to the world, all you know, and because this demand is going to be there. And software and IT enabled services, yes. So these are the main three pillars which you can see on your chat box, that adding new pillars to export basket. And this makes me very proud, you know, to share this news that India has become the world's second largest manufacturer of PPE kits within a period of just 2 months, you know. And the production of PPE kits, masks, ventilators and testing kits, you know, are self-sufficient for the Indian population. You know, we don't need to import this kind of materials to, you know, save the pandemic or control the pandemic. India has really proved it as an Atmanirbhar, you know, in the area of PPE kits. If we also see the CoroSure, all right, the CoroSure, India made the corona testing kits, and this has been developed indigenously, and it is much cheaper, all right, than any other kit. And this is what the country needs, you know, that the cheap and reliable kits to control the pandemic. And this kit has really received and ICMR approvals, declaring the highest score. So we can, that is Indian Council of Medical Research, has given an approval and has given the rights, all right, to CoroSure. And even the IIT Delhi has also given the certification. So this is really a very good thing of India, and we India can be very, very proud of, yeah. Important thing is to encourage India, all right, if we move forward, is to encourage Indian companies to invest heavily in Africa. As we said that in the previous slides, that nobody is looking into African market, you know. Nowadays, the Chinese ceramic and pharma companies, all right, are investing heavily in the African manufacturing. So if even India starts looking in investing in African manufacturing, all right, which will create a long-term market for exports, of the intermediate products, machinery parts, and you know, those kind of consultancy. So we can start looking into this area to increase our exports. Again, another important is to intensify the export oriented research and development. So the government should facilitate establishment of R&D centers, all right, under the public and private partnership. This is one suggestion what I think we can give to the government, that to set up an industry related R&D centers, the central government can launch a scheme for the funding of industry based on R&D and societies where government agencies, commercial organizations, consultants, and trade associations can come together to foster the research in a particular sector, right? So in Gujarat also, if we all can get together along with our state government, the central government, the trade associations, the importers, the exporters, and if we all can make a plan to give it to the government for R&D and for example, the add value to the products like castor oil. So Gujarat is having a huge market of castor oil derivatives, all right? And we can also look into this kind of product, and this kind of association can be made as a non-profit organization for partnership with international educations and research organizations. So the similar, I mean, why I am quoting you this example, that a similar R&D center has been set up by Coimbatore Forging Associations, where the members collected rupees 10 crores and the central government provided 30 crores and Tamil Nadu government gave land to set up the product development and skilling center. So I think that with the research and development based on market research, our export potential is very high in agribusiness. Agriculture is the main pillar of our Indian economy. And if we can look into products of agri-based products such as processed foods, ready-to-eat, ready-to-cook categories, certain snacks and juices, you know, then the market is tremendous. If we even take the example of pomegranate, pomegranate in Gujarat is having a huge plantation and huge production, but nobody is exporting pomegranate juices to foreign countries. And pomegranate is having a longest climate season in India. So I think that if we change the pomegranates, Indian pomegranates, to juices, and if we export, then definitely we can keep the ball rolling. And even natural honey. Natural honey is also another example where this kind of intensive tracing based production is there. And if we start looking into these kind of small products, which does not need much technology, then yes, India can definitely displace China and India can, you know, be number one. These are some of the alternative solutions for international trade. COVID-19 is the shortage of inland trucking. All right, nowadays, if we are not able to get the trailers, or you know, the drivers are not there, we can look for inland rails and inland river barges. All right, so that is an option which the Indian exporters can consult the logistic service providers or the shipping companies to find out which is the shortest way or how they can reach domestically to the port. All the dry ports are also there. International sea and air freight routes also needs to be found out. All right, international rails are also there. All right, and we can find out some rails from China to Russia, and whether it is possible or not. And as I also gave the example of the Burma Thailand route, you know, so certain things can be looked into. Even we can look into hubs for receiving and distribution. if everything is not possible, the exporters can get together and make a warehouse kind of, you know, identify a warehouse in certain countries, and from where the ongoing distributions can be taken place, so that we could have the shortening of the supply chain. All right. Then chartering can be reduced to the part cargo, and this is how we could look into, and multiple gateways for diversification. Now diversification is very, very important, and you know, you need to find out whether which are the main gateways. Like, you know, if Navasheva is chucked up, is there are vessels maybe are delayed, you can look into Mundra, you can look into Hazira. And you know, you can find out which is the gateway for your best product, and how you can do certain things. Yeah, and this is the last about the fourth pillar. All right, that is the reducing trade barriers to export. This is the fourth pillar that you see on your screen, is India's export forecast. You know that reducing the trade barriers, the government is negotiating the trading blocks, reducing looking into reducing certain non-tariff barriers, and one should, I think, keep updates on changing rules and regulations in the export markets. DGFT is facilitating all the exporters, and very regularly we are seeing amendments and policy changes, and you know, if there is any product amendments, we are seeing the notifications from them. So now everything is online, so you need to check about your product, whether that product is freely exportable item or it is coming under restricted, because the demand and supply is changing every time. So you need to keep a watch on the website, and just check about the safety of you know, the protection of people, the livestock, the plants, or you know, to protect the local industry on a regular basis. So this is the fourth main pillar that you see on your chat box, is reducing the trade barriers to exports. All right, and open sector, you know, this is open sector specific warehouses, showrooms in major markets. So this I would like to just share that nowadays getting close to customers is essential in today's just-in-time business environment. You have to keep your customers close to your heart and be in touch with them, whether he's really going to buy things from you or he has diversified the supplier and he has gone to some other market. So central government is also providing subsidies, all right, for this kind of warehouses and showrooms if you are buying in any other markets, but nobody is able to avail the benefits of this subsidy that is given by the government. There are no takers for this benefit. For example, a showroom and a cum warehouse for a building and construction product can be opened in the Panama Free Trade Zone, all right? And it attracts the wholesalers and buyers all across the South America. So no need for you to go and sell your product in South America. You can very well open a warehouse, all right? Or you can think of opening a warehouse. You can talk to the government, apply for it in this free trade zone. The buyers will automatically reflect and come to that area where your selling becomes very much easy to reach those buyers, and more or less the government is also giving you the subsidies for that kind of business. Leveraging India diaspora, all right? There are millions of people, as you all know, of Indian origin settled abroad. Every hook and corner you see Indian in all the countries. People have migrated, but they still love the taste of India. They still love the products of India, all right? And we are often holding, you know, programs for them to invest in India. So we always tell them to come to India and invest. But in this pandemic situation, they should also be roped in to promote Indian products and form a JV to invest in their country. So this is how, if a JV is formed in foreign countries, you know, then Indian products becomes very easy to sell, to reach the buyer, and no need for us to go door to door and people, at least the if the JV has been made, you know, people will attract for the Indian products, and you know, our exports can in a way grow. Promotion of hydroponics and vertical farms for organic and value added products. So this is also one area where this is adding value to increase Indian exports. All right, that is the herbal extracts, what has been traced and geotagged, contamination free and substantially grown. So uses are like 90% less water and electricity is there. But the market for medicinal plants and their extract exports is growing very fast. So those who are into this kind of exports or this kind of areas can definitely look for exporting the hydroponics and vertical farms, you know, to grow their exports. Cross-border e-commerce, I think there are huge talks about cross-border e-commerce, and India needs to really do well, you know, in selling through e-commerce. But as of now, what we see is there has been no strategy at any level to crack this market in China, Africa, Japan, or, you know, ASEAN, you know. So e-commerce is, why not India develop a website like Alibaba? There are websites like Alibaba, such as, you know, IndiaMart, Trade India, who has been introducing buyers and sellers, you know, like a matchmaker. But there is nothing value addition in these websites, or they are nowhere near to what Alibaba is doing, and you know, in terms of scale and in terms of global research. So India needs to create, I think so, B2B websites to support the Indian exporters, you know, to get the global exposure, and products can really sell very, very fast. And increase trade fair participation. All right. So as we discussed, well, just now there is an air of pandemic, but once everything gets back to normal, all right, I think India should participate in regional market trade fairs. For example, Morocco. Morocco is number one in Africa in passenger automobiles, but we are not participating in these kind of trade fairs. India is not having any participation. Even Tunisia is positioning itself as a hub of auto parts. So my request to the automobile exporters is to look into Africa and Morocco. You know, this is a hub of exporting the parts wherein you can place your products and do the networking and try and get. So overall, India's participation with West Africa is very, very poor. All right. And to sum up about our today's presentation is the export strategy. We have discussed that, you know, country focused. We have to now sell on country. Country focused, which are providing demand stimulus, and you know, emerging markets, encash anti-China sentiments. This is very, very important that nowadays everybody is anti-China. So we should encash that anti-China sentiments and explore to those countries having, you know, anti-China sentiments led by US and Europe, Japan, encourage domestic sources and re-strategize everything, you know, in such a way that we can do much better. So if China can multiply its exports by 12 times in 20 years, then why cannot India? So if you see the GDP of China, which had fallen during the pandemic, but now it's a V curve, all right? China is coming back aggressively to regain their economy. And if China can recover sharply, then why cannot India? So let us all together be vocal for local to go global and make India as an Atmanirbhar Bharat. So thank you very much for this presentation.
You are absolutely correct, Manisha. Thank you very much for your nice presentation. You have collected a very nice database and given to this our platform. The people will definitely going to be encouraged and enthused with all these motivational things what you have suggested. Yes. The few things I would like to point out particularly, showing the different sea route or the sea cum land route for a certain inland destinations. Really, it is a good opportunity to rework on this and our normal routing.
Yes, sir.
And looking towards the other countries,
yes, say sir.
African countries, you may have a Uganda or other countries which is by the people, but it has a very good business.
Yes,
Lithuania,
sir.
And all the small country like such countries are such a having a potential. Yes, there is a some risk on the finance part,
yeah,
but you can always take assistance from the ECGC on this point,
yeah,
and explore your market.
Exactly.
Regarding
exactly.
your other suggestions, I do agree that yes, India has to develop this B2B platform like this Alibaba or other things, because it is a definitely a stage or a platform which is providing a very wider connecting with the actual buyer as well as the seller.
Exactly.
Today the IndiaMart is there, but IndiaMart is promoting more or less towards a very very small trader people, not the actual manufacturer.
Exactly.
Or the real people who are actually engaged in the manufacturing of the particular product. So getting a particular product from a IndiaMart detail, it is not that useful to a people as compared to the all other websites are there. That is number one. The other part, what this Manisha has suggested is absolutely correct regarding this reworking of the entire logistics cost, looking your own production cost as well as the actual production pattern what you are handling. And the few suggestions regarding the alternate products of the exports, for example, she said about this pomegranate and all other things. Yes, there are potential. Apeda is doing their best and promoting all these fruits and vegetables, fresh fruits exports. You can see the overall refer traffic in last 1 year, 1-to-1, as compared to the previous 5 years, it has really increased. Yes, people have diverted towards the Indian products. And frankly speaking, across the globe, people love the only thing that products availability.
Yes.
At the affordable price is not there. Definitely.
And now is the best time for us to...
All our manufacturer, industrial, and the fruit and processed vegetable industry people to rethink, rework out on all the things, how we can promote India as our brand, Indian as a product.
Yes, this is the right time for us to encash the anti-China sentiments.
Ma'am, can we go ahead with the question answer session?
Yeah, yeah.
The floor is open. If anybody has any question and answering, you can ask to ma'am.
Yes. So, please send in the chat, and you will be allowed to unmute by the host.
Yes, I see a question from Mayur Parekh. Excellent coverage, ma'am. Would you appreciate if you could share us the soft copy of the presentation? Yes, Mr. Mayur, we will be sending the PPT to Exim Club, and you can get the soft copy from Exim Club itself.
We shall be trying to give this a link of this webinar in this live portion also.
Yes.
Last webinar, we have already done that. So for this also, we will try to link.
All right.
Create the special link and share it to each and every person.
Yeah.
So that whomsoever has not joined for their own problem or for some technical reason,
yes,
they can get the benefit.
So I hope the presentation was good. If you all enjoyed it and got it, please type yes. And I look forward to seeing
you all. I want the TNC to just... give us some questions or some comments, please.
Yeah, good morning. Good afternoon.
Yeah, good afternoon.
So today I sent you this profit and loss account and balance sheet plus this CA certificate, three documents. You want me to, the soft copy is okay for you?
Yes, the soft copy will be sent.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. No issue.
Well done, Manisha, and well done, Vijay. Proud of you both. Keep going.
Thank you, sir. Pranam.
Thank you. Thank you. With well your done. Blessings, we can sir, definitely Sarka. Move on.
Surely. I'm very proud of you both.
Keep blessing us. Keep blessing Exim Club.
Yeah, sure. All blessings to you.
And my request to all the non-members of Exim Club is to have the continuity on this platform, because Exim Club is very aggressive in webinars, and sharing the latest and updated information. So we request all the non-members to be the members and come in our nest of Exim Club. We will be happy to have you all with us.
Yes, you are absolutely correct. So, with this note of stay fit, stay safe.
Thank you.
I'm just ending this session. Thank you, one and all,
thank
who
you.
Has joined in this session.
Thank you. My sincere thank you to all the participants for your valuable time and the opportunity has been given. Thank you, and Jai Hind.
Jai Hind.